This is keratoconus, and it's estimated 1 in 2,000 people have this, with more recent studies showing 1 in 375 people. And still, with it that common, it's often undetected or underdiagnosed in eye exams. Let's focus in why. Now, I get questions about keratoconus all of the time, and so I'm building a video playlist, and I'll put the link to this playlist in the top of the description so you can actually check that out and learn all the information that you want to. Now, today, we are talking about what keratoconus is, what might cause it, the symptoms people might experience, and overall, what can you do to find out if you have keratoconus? What are some tests that we can do to diagnose this? Now, let's break down the word keratoconus. It's actually derived from Greek, with kerato or kerato meaning cornea, and conus meaning cone. So it's literally saying cornea cone or coned cornea. Now, the cornea is the clear dome on the front of the eye. This is where a contact lens sits, and it's pretty much the window to the eye. Normally, it's shaped like a sphere or a dome. Now, in keratoconus, that same cornea actually progressively thins to the point where the cornea starts to bulge or cone out into the shape of a cone. This coned cornea can progressively thin to the point where it will scar, and that scar can block or distort the vision, or it can cause other problems. It can be painful, or it can cause the cornea to collapse. Now, what exactly causes keratoconus? Now, this is still not fully understood, meaning we don't know the exact cause to keratoconus. We do know that there is a mixture of genetic component and an environmental component there. Now, there are a few things that we do know about keratoconus and a few things that are associated with keratoconus. It usually presents itself in the teenage years or the 20s. It's almost always bilateral, but oftentimes there is one eye that kind of starts showing the symptoms first, or there's oftentimes one eye that's more severe than the other eye. Now, one environmental factor that is strongly associated with keratoconus, and that is eye rubbing. If you have eye allergies, itchy eyes, and you tend to deep knuckle rub into your eyes, that actually has a strong link to the development of keratoconus. So if you are someone that does have seasonal eye allergies or atopic conjunctivitis, it's related to eczema, food allergies, asthma, you might be more prone to rubbing your eyes. And this is something that you do want to pay attention to. If you are rubbing, deep rubbing your eyes, you want to see how often, how much, because you want to try and avoid that as much as possible. The less that you can do that, that improves your chances of not developing keratoconus. And a couple other things that are associated with keratoconus is Down syndrome and Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. And with the genetic component, if you have someone in your immediate family that does have keratoconus, that puts you at a 16 to 67 times more likely to get keratoconus yourself, compared to someone that doesn't have any keratoconus in the immediate family. So what are the symptoms of keratoconus, and why can it sometimes fly under the radar during an eye exam? Talking about visual symptoms, obviously it can cause blurry vision, especially at nighttime. People have lights that streak out, they'll have glare and halos, especially a lot of glare for sure. They might even say that they're seeing kind of ghosting effects. If they're looking at somebody, they might see another kind of ghost image coming or stretching off of that person. If it's bad enough, sometimes they'll actually say, hey, I'm seeing double vision in that one eye. A lot of times when they're looking at the letters on the eye chart, they'll say, I see the letter, but I also see another separate letter coming off of it, almost like an extreme backdrop to that letter. Now, what's interesting is a lot of these symptoms do mimic and are they're the same as someone having regular astigmatism. But usually with someone with keratoconus, they're developing something called irregular astigmatism. Someone with regular astigmatism still has a nice dome shape to their cornea, but maybe one part of the cornea is more curved than the other one. That's regular astigmatism, that most everybody actually has some form of this type of astigmatism. But someone with irregular astigmatism, specifically from keratoconus, will not only just have one curve that's more curved to the cornea, but will have multiple different curves at different angles. And so usually the vision in someone with irregular astigmatism is just an amplified astigmatism or amplified regular astigmatism. when they're looking at lights and glare, instead of having one or two streaks, they might have streaks just going in different directions. Their glare and halos and ghosting might be coming from different angles and different directions as well. Or they might look at a letter on an eye chart, and instead of just having one ghosting effect, they might have multiple in different directions, or maybe they have one main one and then some coming off of that one as well. And so it's just a next level or added layers to that astigmatism. Another fairly common symptom is a frequent change in prescription, whether you're nearsighted or if you have astigmatism. And this can especially be true when keratoconus is first starting to present itself in those teenage years or in those 20s. This person might get a new prescription and then feel like maybe weeks to months later, hey, my vision just got blurry again. I need to update my prescription. Another thing with the prescription, at least on the doctor side, when we're trying to determine the prescription, sometimes we can't get that patient fully corrected to 20/20, the bottom of the chart, or there might be some fluctuation in the answers, especially when we're trying to determine the astigmatism amount, where this patient might, ooh, I really like this answer, and then later decide, ooh, I really like this answer. And so it's kind of all over the map. There's not really a easy set number to put in that prescription. And that is something fairly common in a patient with keratoconus. In one eye or maybe both eyes, they're not able to be corrected to 20/20 vision with glasses. And the reason why is if you have a cone-shaped cornea with multiple curves, but you're using glasses with one, maybe two sets of curves in there, it's unable to fully correct for the different powers in different angles. And so no matter what you do with the glasses, it doesn't fully correct the vision, doesn't give them nice crisp vision. Why is it possible for this to fly under the radar where the doctor doesn't really know this person has keratoconus or the patient? And what are some of the tests that we can do during an eye exam to actually diagnose someone with keratoconus? So oftentimes with keratoconus, there are some extra tests that we need to do to fully diagnose someone with keratoconus. In a comprehensive exam, we are measuring prescription and curvature of the eye, but sometimes during the prescription, we can actually correct someone to 20/20. Now, they might not have that perfect crisp vision, but a doctor might say, hey, I was able to correct them to 20/20. There wasn't really much of a fluctuation. They feel confident in that glasses prescription. So the red flag or the alarm bells don't go off in the doctor's head. Or there is a portion in the exam where we actually measure corneal curvature. This is called keratometry, where it might measure what curve the cornea is at. Now, a lot of times the curvature of keratoconus might be missed because a lot of those numbers can show up in a normal range. And again, no alarm bells or red flags will go up for the doctor that's doing the exam. Or even when we're doing the slit lamp exam, evaluating the cornea with a microscope, sometimes those subtle keratoconus changes, the thinning in the cornea or the coning out, might not be as evident, especially in those early stages. And so unless we are looking for some minute thinning to the cornea or looking at it from different angles and going slow and looking for subtle changes, it is possible that can be missed in those early stages. But there are a few extra tests that actually can fully diagnose and let us know if we are dealing with keratoconus. One is called a corneal topography, where you can actually map the surface of the cornea for any irregularities in any irregular astigmatism to actually see if there's any steepening or cone shape formation that is starting to show up. Another one is called a corneal tomography, where you can actually take a 3D image of the layers of the cornea, including the posterior or the innermost layer of the cornea. And the reason why that's important is usually that innermost layer or the posterior layer of the cornea is usually the first layer to show some irregularities or show some curvature or thinning to the corneal structure. Another test is corneal pachymetry, where you measure the thickness of the cornea and you can see if there is any thinning that is happening if you are outside a normal range there. Now, what makes it hard is a lot of places do not perform these tests in a normal comprehensive exam. These are usually specific tests that might be ordered by an eye doctor to really diagnose and confirm what might be showing up in the comprehensive exam. So if that patient does well during an exam, gets glasses, can see well, they might not know that they're walking around with the early stages of keratoconus. So if you're going into your eye exam and you're curious if you have keratoconus, try and be as specific as possible with your symptoms, your nighttime vision, exactly what you're seeing. Let the doctor know if you tend to rub your eyes, knuckle rub your eyes, or if you have any family members with keratoconus. And this might let the doctor know, hey, I should pay attention to this and maybe order some extra testing. And so the key to keratoconus and treating keratoconus is early detection. And because of that, I am doing a whole dedicated video about the treatments for keratoconus. And when that's ready, I'll put it right here. Otherwise, you can check out my keratoconus playlist right here. And if you have any questions, leave them in the comments. Stay focused.